how do you reflect on all those years of toil and tribulation and the immense media exposure and all the woes before it all came good?
I think it was my twin brother, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. It's all surreal to think we started the journey back in the 70s. And obviously, the great late Colin Chapman gave me the opportunity with Lotus. I mean, trials and tribulations you went through those years, and having all the accidents we had because the barriers were right on the edge of the circuit. So a little bit envious of the drivers today. They can move back a little bit now. But no, fantastic. And it's like a number of things. You reflect and you just go, you know, did you really do that? But it was sensational. Brilliant journey. And then cumulating the driving in America with the late Paul Newman. Anyone know Paul Newman, the film star? What a wonderful man. And Carl Haas with the Newman Haas team. So many stories of the adventure in America and the rest of the world in Formula One.
When you came through Formula Ford and Formula 3 and a little bit of Formula 2, you broke your neck, you broke your back. It didn't put you off.
Yeah, it did.
It must have put those out.
And the feet. It's just, you know, our feet were very close, about that far from the front nose cone. So when we hit anything on the front of the car, the feet got the shock waves. And obviously I had a couple of very big accidents, and we didn't have proper seats back in the 70s and 80s. We used to sit on the metal floor of the car, because obviously it wasn't carbon fibre then. And because when you had an accident, the shock wave just went straight up to the spine, and the spine just went whoop. So I used to be 6'7", ladies and gentlemen. A little bit shorter now.
When Grand Prix racing, when Grand Prix drivers were real men, yeah?
No, I'm not saying that at all. It's just that, you know, we did have a psyche difference that if we went into a corner at 200 miles an hour, we had to be committed to do and get around that corner, because the barrier is just where you are now. So if we made a mistake, we were in that barrier. Whereas now, the psyche is very different. They go into the corners on the majority of circuits, and there's an extraordinary runoff of tarmac. So they can get it wrong, go straight off the track and drive straight on. And then they complain that there isn't that much grip there and there, but they didn't hit the barrier.
You did 5 years with Lotus. Your great mentor, the man who really made it all happen for you, Colin Chapman, he died halfway through your period with Lotus. Was that a wrench for you? Do you think?
It was devastating, still devastating today to think about it, because without Colin and the Chapman family, I would not be here today speaking to you and have the opportunity to drive a Formula One car. So, I mean, Colin was everything. He was like a second father to me. We spoke the same language, because I was a qualified engineer, and we had a fantastic time. And even all these years later, I still can't believe he was taken from us so early. And such a shame, because you know, it was a wonderful time at Lotus.
He was only 55, wasn't he? Or thereabouts?
Yeah, I mean, I sometimes like to listen to some of the nonsense and think that he's living somewhere nice in Argentina, but no, but he was a marvellous man, charismatic, so clever, and you know, a wonderful man that changed my whole family's life.
Do you think you might have stayed at Lotus for 85 if Colin had been around?
Absolutely, I'd have been there for my whole career, probably.
And of course, the cars got better and better, didn't they, in the mid-80s, the Lotus?
Yeah, I mean, you know, there's evolution, and we got into the turbo era. As everyone says to me, what's the best era to drive in? For me, the Mustang of all Formula One cars, and I'm sorry, the present day car doesn't cut it for me, was the 84, 85, 86, 87 season, where you had upwards of 1,500 horsepower qualifying, and you had wheel spin at sixth gear at 176 miles an hour, and the car was trying to throw you off at every corner and kill you. The cars then were just absolutely amazing. They were beasts. They were beasts, and you had to still change gear then, and if you get it wrong with the foot, you'd blow the engine up in a second.
I love the way you described that. That's brilliant. It's true though, wasn't it? I
mean, Martin Brundle, the great commentator of Formula One, I mean, he said the best era for him was that era, and he actually used the words. He said the cars always were trying to throw you off the circuit and kill him.
The turbos, the technology wasn't there, so the throttle was like a light switch, wasn't it?
A funny story, ladies and gentlemen, some of you know, I must tell you, and thanks for that intro there. It was when I joined Williams in 85, I was second race, I was going to the grid, and it started to rain, and I was going around a long corner, and all I did was put my foot down on the throttle, and there's no power came on. I took my foot off, I started to turn around the corner, and without my foot on the throttle, because there was like a 3 second time lag, 650 horsepower chimed in, spun me straight off and had an accident coming to the grid. So I had to start the race from the pit lane, because I had to replace the front suspension. Very embarrassing to have an accident on your own going to the grid, but you literally had to count 1, 2, 3, and you had to time it in the corners when you wanted the power and you didn't. And if the power didn't come at the right time, you'd just go off and hit the wall. So it really was quite interesting.
Your big break came when you joined Frank Williams. At the end of 85, you won at Brands. And from then until really 92, you were at the front. We saw 120,000 people at Silverstone. They invaded the track. I mean, you were a national treasure.
No, the fans are a national treasure. We're just doing our job. But what we do, you know, I think the fans will agree, when Patrick Head always said this about me, when I was in the car, I always gave over 100%. I never held anything back. And that great race at Brands Hatch in 85, 86, and then doing the triple in 87, and hunting down my lovely teammate Nelson Piquet at Silverstone, is my best friend for the rest of my life.
Have you made friends with Nelson now?
No.
Brilliant. Anybody at Brands in 85 or 86? Silverstone 87?
Yeah, good.
The audience is getting younger, isn't it? That's my worry. Only a few of them were there.
Well, I'm 28 now. How old are you?
The championship in 86 and 87 was taken away from you. I mean, really frustrating. You came so close.
Yeah, I mean, in 86 we were going down, we had about 18 laps to go, in third place. Just had to sort of finish the race, and then everyone knew the tyre blew, and we're doing just over 200 miles an hour down the straight when the tyre blew up. And it's just one of those things, isn't it? Except that if I'd have crashed in the wall and bounced back out, they would have stopped the race, it'd gone over two-thirds distance, and then I would have been champion from the lap before. So, but being bridesmaid three times is not much fun, but we got there in the end, didn't we, ladies and gentlemen? That's the main thing, we got there in the end.
You'd have been really annoyed if you'd been told at the end of 86 it would be 6 years more toil and tribulation to get there.
Well, the fans were incredibly supportive. I think that's when we became the People's World Champion, which was a wonderful accolade. But all the reporters said, well, you might as well retire now, you never get another opportunity. All the great support you have from the press, remember that? Retire now, you never get another chance.
Good old Stan Peacher in the sun, you and Nelson. So, just brilliant.
We stood there, and obviously when you get knocked down, you stand back up. And you know, a lot of people have a lot of adversity, and that's what makes you stronger, isn't it? Never give up.
Tell us why you left Williams, the comfort zone of Williams, to go to Ferrari.
Well, it's simple, I was fired. I had a happy day for 24 hours and I was told I wasn't required. So
after a tricky year with the Judd.
No problem at all, but you know, Paul Newman was absolutely fantastic. He said, look, come to America and have an adventure. When one door closes, another one opens. And we had the 2 years in America, which was incredibly exciting. And then, for all sorts of commercial reasons, you remember that Sir Frank Williams decided to sell the Honda engine for $24 million to Ron Dennis for Ayrton and Allen to dominate the championship. And so I was very disappointed in 88 that we were driving a car which was terribly uncompetitive, and obviously Ferrari came along and said we'd like to drive for us. So wonderful opportunity with Ferrari, and a very funny quick story I'll tell you with Ferrari. Wonderful team to drive for. I went there for the first day, and there was a racing Ducati in the corner. I walked past. All I said, ladies and gentlemen, it's a lovely Ducati. 1 week later, one wife at my home at three. It's beautiful. My wife wasn't very happy, but came.
I went. You ever ride it?
Yeah, I did. Yeah, and then another tester went there. They wanted me to drive a new Testarossa from the factory. I drove it around and said, well, I think you should soften the suspension a little bit at the front, put a bit of understeer in it, because there's a bit sort of sharp going into the corners. 2 weeks later, a brand new Testarossa came, £170,000, for free. It was wonderful. So then about a month later, we were testing there at Maranello again, and as probably some of you know, for over 30 years, I've been a jet pilot. We were running late, so they lent me one of the Falcon 900s to fly down to Estoril, and the captain let me be captain of the plane. The plane was absolutely fantastic. I got off the plane, I said to the captain, I said, please tell Mr. Ernie Elliott and Fry, this is the most fantastic plane I've ever been on. I'm still waiting. It's only worth 34 million, but I'm still waiting. There's a limit of generosity, but I had a wonderful time at Ferrari.
Surely you could buy that out right now.
Oh, no way.
I don't believe it. You were the last driver to be signed to Scuderia Ferrari by Enzo Ferrari. Describe the emotions of going into that room. He's behind the desk with the glasses on.
The incredible thing with Enzo was, I don't forget the one meal we had in this big restaurant with about 40 of us around the table, and the noise the Italians make eating and chatting in the restaurant is extraordinary. And then I was sitting right next to Enzo, and then he just moved his hand. All he did was did this. Before it went this far, you could hear a pin drop. And everyone was waiting just in case he wanted to say something. Quiet like anything. Now all he did then was pick up the salt and do a little bit of that, and then everyone started talking again. The power of someone like that was amazing to witness, and the respect that he had by everybody.
Did he sign your contract with that purple?
Yeah, he did. That's why I won the first race.
Yeah.
I was going to get fired if I didn't.
Very stale stuff. You booked your flight home, hadn't you, early, because you were convinced wouldn't last.
That was embarrassing. My first race with Ferrari, we had a very terrible winter testing. The car was very quick. John Barnard did a superb job, but the reliability of the car was very poor, especially with the semi-automatic box. So we could go 3 laps, maybe 5 laps, 8 laps if you were really lucky, and then it would just break down. So we went to Rio not full of confidence at all. And anyway, long story short, you had a warm-up then. You know, you used to do more laps in testing. You had a warm-up before the race. I went out and the car did half a lap on the day of the race, and it broke down. So I didn't do any practice for the warm-up, and I came back and in the race, and I saw the captain of British Airways, and I said, can you change my ticket for me? I'll be on the early plane. So they changed my ticket for me, and we get into the race, and I get to about, I'm in fifth space, spot going down the main straight there, and I'm going, how many laps have I done? I've got 3. Oh, that's not bad. So fourth lap comes, I'm up to fourth, and I'm going, oh, that's all right. And then fifth lap comes, I'm up to third. And now I'm starting to get angry in the car. The car's going really well. I'm in third place. I'm just going to break down any minute. I mean, I really know it's going to break down any minute. So anyway, another lap or so goes past, I'm up to second. I'm going, oh, going really well. And then I get into the lead. And now I'm really angry because I'm going, I'm in the lead now, don't you dare break down. And then the next lap I come round, Gerhard Berger, my teammate, has exploded on the side of the circuit, steam coming from the car. And I'm looking at the car, forgetting I'm in first place, thinking, I am not a happy chap. It's going to be one or two laps more and I'm going to be broken down. So anyway, we get to half the race and I'm tender hooks all the time. And I'm going down the straight and I'm just going to let you hold the mic for a second here to my mouth. I'm going down the straight and my steering goes like that and I'm going in a straight line. And so the car didn't break down but the bolts came out of the steering wheel. So I made an emergency stop to the pits and I changed 5 wheels and tyres, 4 with tyres on and the other one was a steering wheel in the car. And the chief mechanic slammed the steering wheel on and I had a knob on my radio about this long and he stabbed his hand and it scarred to this day. So anyway, we come out, obviously off to the stop, we get back to first place again, and I've never driven a race in my life, even ever since that race. I've been on tenderhooks for the whole race, and we won the race. I mean, you can't believe it, it's fate. And it took, I think, another 7 races for either Gerhard and I to finish another race. So it's like a little mini miracle for Ferrari, that race.
And then in classic Mansell style, you cut your hands on the trophy. On the podium.
It was like razor blades, wasn't it? It was incredible. Again, Brazil, wasn't it? They fixed it. They put some razor blades on it for me.
Yeah, brilliant.
Oh, I've got to tell you, it was wonderful before the race. I was so happy to be broken down in the warm-up for half a lap. And it was right opposite the grandstands. And the fans there were fantastic. They were throwing bricks at me and water. And they're so supportive of me against Ayrton and Allen and Nelson, of course. So I wish some of you guys would have been there to help me.
They
loved me winning the race, so I said, well done.
British Grand Prix 1990, the car broke at Copse. You threw your gloves into the crowd.
I retired.
You retired. What was the motivation behind that? And how long had you been?
Oh, you're asking me all the difficult questions, you are here. I mean, I went there and I had Greg Norman, my friend, with me, and Barry Sheen, and, you know, wonderful Barry. Shame he's not with us. But anyway, I sit in my car because the British Grand Prix is most important for me. It doesn't fit me properly. Anyway, long story short, they swapped the cars. Alan was now my number one driver, and he said he wanted my qualifying car. I think it was from Paul Ricard the week before. So I got the team to actually admit to me that they swapped my cars because they said my car was the same and it wasn't. So I was really quite angry because I wanted my car that fitted me properly. And Greg Norman said to me, he said, well, just upset them. I said, well, how can I do that? Can I hit somebody? He said, no, you can't do that. I said, well, how can I do it? He said, well, go out in Alan's car and get pole position, which I did, which was fantastic. And then before the race, ask him which car he wanted for the race. So it was a wonderful relationship. It was really, really great.
You've made peace with Alan, haven't you? You've made peace with Alan. There's a lovely moment at the F1 Sports
Day. It's fine. I mean, you know, Alan was outright number one and he came to the team. And Ferrari were fantastic. They brought my number one contract out to me because they said that's exactly what they were going to do. So they were honourable. So I can't knock that.
I've got a little bit of something. You bringing your...
Yeah, my wife brought me a nice wallet which I wanted to show somebody. It's a bit like a race car. It's very strange device, that, isn't it? Anything can catch on fire any time. You never know what's going to happen.
There's never been a fire on my stage before. Listen, we've got to crack on. I've got a surprise for you, and I've got an even bigger surprise for an incredible young man backstage who is desperate to meet you. I will just say, ladies and gentlemen, and you need to clap a lot and scream and shout. You all know who he is. He is truly a remarkable young kid, hugely inspiring. He wants to meet one of his great racing heroes. Please welcome Billy Munger.
The lion heart beats the young lion heart, ladies and gentlemen.
How cool is that? Honestly, wow. You know, you think you're having a bad day, and you hurt yourself in a racing car, and it's nothing.
Billy's an inspiration to us all. And I mean, I can honestly say with the technology and everything else, he might even go all the way and be a Formula One world champion in the future. You'd like that, wouldn't you?
I'd love that.
We would love it too, come on. We would love it.
He's in the live action, ragging a 600 brake horsepower V8 Jaguar with hand controls, like he's been doing it his whole life.
Now tell us about
it. Some people are special, aren't they?
I've been having too much fun in that car, honestly. I think it's the most powerful car I've ever been in, and everywhere I go, it has to be sideways in it, which is kind of, it doesn't help the fact that it's completely different to driving a single-seater car at top level, but yeah, I'm loving it.
Ladies and gentlemen, stunt king Terry Grant is down there. He's just gesticulated to me. There were no hand controls. He was doing it with the pedals, for God's sake.
I saw the TV programme explain to him, because he was showing us on TV,
yeah,
to drive it.
It was
actually very good.
So basically, with obviously normally when you drive with a normal car with pedals, that you all the movement comes from your ankle and how you control the pedal. So what I've had to do, obviously, because there's a lack of an ankle there at the minute. all through the hip at the minute is how I'm controlling the stunt car. So it's all about generating that movement through there, and that's how I can kind of still get a feel for the pedal, which is good for me, really. Like to be able to know I can still control the car in a good enough way to handle one of those beasts.
You've been humbled and inspired, haven't you, by the outpouring of support from the motor racing industry. Nigel, it's a family. It's a small thing, and the guys, including Lewis Hamilton, have reached out to this young guy.
Yeah,
it's been great.
He's just absolutely fantastic. And I mean, Billy must understand he carries the weight and the shoulder of the whole country going forward. I mean, sorry about that. Everyone's behind you now for the rest of your career. So, I mean, but the opportunity, I mean, I'm thinking of one here. I mean, I shouldn't really say it, but, you know, you've got a girlfriend at the moment. But let's say she's 6'6", right? You can. Doesn't matter, you can, whatever.
I know where this is going.
Brilliant. Classic.
But you're going to get into a Formula One car? Have you had any invites yet?
I've not had an invite yet. I'm waiting for that Mercedes seat to free
up. I'll push it for you.
Can you make some calls?
We need to do something. You've got to speak to Lewis and say, have a go in his car.
Yeah, definitely.
I think we should do that. Don't you think, ladies and gentlemen? Yeah. He deserves a Mercedes Formula 1 car. Mercedes, if you're listening, you're under pressure.
They could create something fabulous, couldn't they? No, it's a great opportunity,
but I just want to share you're an inspiration. You really are. I mean, Italy, when I drove for Ferrari, it was an amazing experience for me because they nicknamed me Leone, the Lionheart. But you're the young Lionheart, and you should be a great credit to yourself and the rest of the country. Yes, ladies and gentlemen?
Thanks for that. There's a lot of pressure on my shoulders, but I'll do my best, and that's all I can do. Looking forward to the future.
You've had a lot of help and support from Alex Zanardi, who had a similar predicament to you in that awful accident in Champ Car. He went on to great things. He won World Touring Car races.
Gold medal.
A double Olympian, yeah. I'd like to see you and Alex sharing a car at Le Mans.
Maybe with
Frédéric Sosé as well, who has done Le Mans already. Wouldn't that be cool?
Yeah, I'd love to be a part of that. That'd be awesome. Obviously, Alex has been a huge inspiration to me before and after my crash. Everyone knows the name when you talk about him, and it's all that same determination and spirit that he's got, not only to go back to the sport he loves, but to go into other sports and compete at the highest level and win gold medals. So yeah, if I can be a snippet of what he's managed to achieve in his career, I'd be more than happy.
It's extraordinary, I was listening, how off the back of immense trauma and adversity, he can have a sensational career.
Well, Alex Zanardi is another incredible champion, a dear friend of mine, and with the technology, if it was back then when he had his accident, he'd have been a Formula One world champion then. Alex was a very special talent, but I see something special here. I mean, incredible, and as you said, great opportunity, do your best, keep forging away, and you'll have the support of everybody.
I want Nigel to do a bit of magic on you. Should we do that? Not too much.
Before he does that, I think I've got a little magic trick that I like to call take the leg off trick. Abracadabra. I don't know if you can put anything out that beats that.
I was the heaviest driver in Grand Prix racing. I don't know if you know that. You know, one of the biggest and heaviest when they used to weigh the cars separate to the drivers. So when I went out of the pits, I was always half a second down the lap on someone like Nelson or Ayrton or Allen. This is a little bit smaller. So I'm not going to go anywhere with this, but I've got a special magic trick for you.
We've got 2 minutes because Billy's back in live action.
Yeah. You know how motor racing burns money? Well, has anyone got a £50 note I can actually change into a £20 note? We can't do that, but what we're going to do, we'll freak out. If we can just show you what motor racing does to money here. And it basically just does.
Wow. Wasn't expecting that.
No, no, no,
right. Really,
yeah. It's a funny old world, isn't it? We've got to let you go. Because you've got to go booting around again.
Good luck with
everything. In action.
Well done, Billy. Lovely to see you.
Yeah, thanks
for being part of the show. We wish you every success. We're going to be hearing a lot more about you, I am certain. Ladies and gentlemen, Billy Munger.
Billy.
Thank you.